In this video, we're going to explore improper integrals. So let's look at these two integrals. We've got one where one of the bounds of integration is infinity. So we're looking at the integral from 1 to infinity of 1 over x squared. So let's remember that the infinity symbol simply is a number that keeps growing indefinitely. In the second integral, I have finite bounds, 0 and 1, but there is a vertical asymptote for the integrand when x equals 0. So the first one is an example of a type 1 improper integral, or an infinite integral. And in type 2, we have that infinite discontinuity between its bounds of integration, or at one of the bounds of integration. Now these are called improper integrals because we cannot evaluate them directly using the fundamental theorem of calculus. It is still helpful for us to know the antiderivative, but there's a two-step process. We're going to replace one of the bounds of integration with a parameter. T is the one that we usually use. Then we'll evaluate the integral with this new bound using the FTC. And we'll get a formula for T. Now it makes sense, the bound that we're going to replace is either going to be the infinity or the bound where we have a vertical asymptote. So after we use the fundamental theorem of calculus to find a formula for T, for the antiderivative of the integral using the t bound, then the next thing we have is we want to take the limit of the result of this formula as t approaches the original bound. So let's start with an example. We're going to evaluate the integral from 1 to infinity of 1 over x squared dx. So something like this. So we've got a parameter t. I'm going to replace that infinity with t. That's going to give us some finite amount of area. And essentially, what this integral does is it calculates or provides a formula for that area. So we'll just use the power rule to find the antiderivative, evaluate it between 1 and t, which will give us this formula. So now we go on to step 2. We're going to let t go to infinity, because that was my original bound. So we're going to let t go to infinity, and 1 over t as t goes to infinity goes to 0, so I'm left with 1. So if this limit from step 2 exists and is finite, then that limit value is the value of the improper integral. And we call the improper integral convergent. So these are important words right here. The first one, convergent. We'll be seeing that throughout the course. So we would say that the integral from 1 to infinity of 1 over x squared dx equals 1. Now, if the limit does not exist, or if the limit is infinite, so there's really two cases here. It doesn't always have to be an infinity, but if the limit does not exist, then we say the improper integral is divergent. So formally, we say that if we have an infinite integral, then what we can do is replace that infinity with t, and if that new integral exists for all t to the right of a, then we go ahead and evaluate that integral, then take the limit as t goes to infinity. If that limit exists and is finite, then that would be the value of the proper integral. Now, we don't always have to have an infinite integral growing to the right. It could also have a lower bound, which is negative infinity, but the same process holds. We'll replace the negative infinity with t, and then take the antiderivative, and then take the limit, letting t go to negative infinity. So let me fix that here. We should have the limit down here go to negative infinity. And if that limit exists, then the integral is convergent, and we found the value of the improper integral. Now, you can also have both bounds being infinite, in which case you pick a number, any number, c, and you break it up into two parts. So you'd have one integral with the lower bound of negative infinity, and one integral with the upper bound of infinity. If you find both of those, and usually you have to do both, we're going to see an example where some symmetry could help. But usually you want to do both of these. And if they're both convergent, then you can say that the improper integral with bounds from negative infinity to positive infinity is the converged value, or the sum of the converged value from the left side and the right side. And again, you get to choose this number c. Usually it's pretty clear. Zero is usually a good choice, but sometimes there may be better choices. All right, so these are the kind of instructions that we want to follow here. We have an improper integral. Our first step is to determine, is it divergent or convergent? And if it's convergent, we'd like to find the value. Well, step one, let's go ahead and replace the infinity symbol with t. And find the antiderivative, evaluate it from 1 to t. Our formula is natural log of t. Now we're going to take the limit as t goes to infinity. And as t goes to infinity, the natural log of t also goes to infinity, which means that the improper integral is divergent. All right, here we've got one with bounds from negative infinity to positive infinity. And the integrand is 1 over 1 plus x squared. So we have to check both sides, and it's going to be really convenient for us to choose c equal to 0. So let's start on the left side. We're going to evaluate the integral from negative infinity to 0 of 1 over 1 plus x squared dx. So we'll start by replacing this negative infinity with t. Find the antiderivative. Antiderivative of 1 plus 1 over 1 plus x squared is arctan of x. And this is the graph of arctan of x, so it just helps us evaluating the limits. And when I do the evaluation, I get negative arctan of t. So now we're going to take the limit as t goes to negative infinity of negative arctan of t. So from my graph, if we didn't remember, as t goes to negative infinity, arctan of t goes to negative pi over 2. And so the opposite of negative pi over 2 is going to be pi over 2. So the left side is convergent, and its value is pi over 2. Well, let's do the same thing on the right side. We'll go from 0 to infinity this time. So replace infinity with t. Find the same antiderivative because it's the same integrand. Evaluate it between 0 and t, and I get arctan of t. So now we'll take the limit as t goes to positive infinity. And again, from our graph, if we didn't remember, we can see that arctan of t approaches this horizontal asymptote at pi over 2. And so the entire integral is also going to be convergent. So we've got the left-hand side equaling the right-hand side, both convergent, both equaling pi over 2. Since both sides are convergent, then the entire integral is convergent, and its value is going to be the sum pi over 2 plus pi over 2, which equals pi. And this is a case where choosing 0 could have benefited us. We could have saved a little bit of work because we could take advantage of the symmetry. The integrand 1 over 1 plus x squared is an even function. And so for any value of t, the integral from negative t to 0 of 1 over 1 plus x squared dx is the same as the integral from 0 to t of 1 over 1 plus x squared dx. And when I take the limit, then I would get the same value. So it would have been sufficient in this case maybe to calculate the right-hand side, and then say by symmetry, I'll get the same thing on the left-hand side. Now here's an important example. So p is going to be some real number, doesn't necessarily have to be an integer, but for what values of p is the integral from 1 to infinity of 1 over x to the power of p dx convergent? Well, let's go through our steps. We know that when, in example 2, that this is actually divergent when p equals 1. So we had 1 over x dx, that was divergent. So let's assume p is not equal to 1 and go through the steps. So I'll have to use the power rule, or I'll be able to use the power rule and evaluate that between 1 and t. So power rule says I'm going to add 1 to the exponent. So I have negative p plus 1 divided by the new exponent. And that's kind of an awkward expression or formula that I got after the evaluation. So I'm going to clean up a little bit. Rather than writing negative p plus 1, I'm going to write 1 minus p. But then I'm also going to bring the t down into the denominator, the power of t into the denominator, which means it's going to have the opposite exponent. Instead of negative p plus 1, it's going to have positive p minus 1. So a quick reminder, for taking the limit as t goes to infinity, if I have 1 over t to the power of u, so the exponent on t is any positive number, then that expression will go to 0 as t goes to infinity, because even if I have a very small exponent here, 1 over 100, 1 over 1 million, eventually, as t goes to infinity, the denominator grows without bounds, so its reciprocal goes to 0. But I have to have a positive exponent. Now, if I had a negative exponent, then I could have, like, t, 1 over t to the negative 1 power. Really, that just means I have a polynomial. I would have t to the power of some positive exponent. So that'll go to infinity. So this limit is going to be 1 over p minus 1 if I have a positive exponent, which would mean p has to be greater than 1. So let's remember this. P is the exponent on the x when it's in the denominator. When I write it as a fraction, 1 over x to the power of p. And we get what we call the p-test for integrals. And it's going to have two parts. And this is our first part. And it just says that the integral from 1 to infinity of 1 over x to the power of p dx is convergent if p is greater than 1 and divergent otherwise. So from now on, if you're asked to show if an integral like this is convergent or divergent, you may simply refer to the p-test and say, oh, because of the p-test, if p is greater than 1, it's convergent. If p is less than or equal to 1, you would say it is divergent by the p-test. And one further note is that we don't really have to start at 1 We just chose one because it's customary, but really we could choose any positive number. Obviously it can't be zero because then I have a vertical asymptote. But if I wanted to choose, like I will in another example, pi as my starting number or two as my starting number, then the p-test still works. So those are our infinite integrals. Let's look at the type 2 improper integrals, where there's some kind of infinite discontinuity between A and B, or at A or at B. So here's the example we started with, the integral from 0 to 1 of 1 over radical x dx. Now note, can't use the p-test that we just learned, because our bounds don't go to infinity. This is not an infinite integral. Our bounds go from 0 to 1. Now, our integrand has that vertical asymptote at the lower bound, x equals 0. So that's going to be replaced by my parameter t. And then I need to evaluate this integral, which I can do using the power rule. And I get the formula 2 minus 2 radical t. Now let t go to 0. And with these discontinuous integrands, we're going to be taking one-sided limits, because our bounds go start at the left-hand side and go always to the right up to the upper bound. And so we're going to take the limit as t approaches 0 from the right. And in fact, our integrand isn't even defined on the left side of 0. So we must take a limit as t approaches 0 from the right. And as t approaches 0 from the right, there's no mystery in evaluating the limit. You just get 2. So we have a convergent improper integral, and its value is 2. So formally, the way we state this is that if we're continuous everywhere except for on the right endpoint, or the upper bound of integration, then we have this two-step process. Replace the upper bound with the parameter, evaluate the integral, then take the limit. If that limit exists and is finite, then the integral is convergent, and that gives us the limit value, gives us the value of the integral. And the same idea if you have a discontinuity on the left bound of integration or lower bound of integration. Now, if you have a discontinuity between the bounds, then you have to do two integrals. You need to check the integral from the lower bound to the discontinuity, and then from the discontinuity to the upper bound. If both of those are convergent, then you can say that the integral is convergent and just take the sum of the values from the left and the right integral. So let's see if this integral is convergent. We have a discontinuity at the upper bound now when x equals 5. So we're going to replace the upper bound with our parameter t. So we're replacing the bound where the discontinuity is with t. And I can still use, well, at this point, I know many of you can just go straight and find the antiderivative. I'm going to make a u substitution. And the way I'm going to do the u substitution is to just help me find the indefinite integral. And then I'll change everything back to x and then perform the evaluation. So let's look at the indefinite integral, make the following u substitution. Now I can use the power rule. And now I'm going to go back to x. Now I'm ready to evaluate the definite integral from 0 to t using the antiderivative I just calculated. That gives me this formula. Now step 2, I'll take the limit as t approaches 5 from the left, because that's my upper bound. 5 is my upper bound, so all my values of interest are to the left of 5. And so as t approaches 5 from the left, 5 minus t approaches 0. And so I'm left with 3 halves, 5 to the 2 thirds power. Well, 5 to the 2 thirds power means 5 squared to the 1 third power, which is the cube root of 25. So the improper integral is convergent, and its value is 3 halves cube root of 25. So let's see if we can finish our p-test. Now we're going to have bounds from 0 to 1 of 1 and the integral 1 over x to the power of p dx. So the integrand here has a vertical asymptote at x equals 0. So we will replace that bound with t. Now, if p equals 1, I have 1 over x, so the antiderivative is going to be natural log of x. For any other value of p, I can use the power rule. So I'll get two different formulas depending upon if I have p equal to 1. After my evaluation, I'll get negative natural log of 2. For any other value of p, I'll have 1 over 1 minus p, and then in brackets, 1 minus x to the power of 1 minus p. Same thing that we saw previously. The integrand is the same that we saw in our previous p-test integral. It's just the bounds are different. And now we're going to take the limit as t approaches 0 from the right of each of those formulas. So for when p equals 1, as t approaches 0 from the right, natural log of t approaches negative infinity, but I have the negative natural log of t, so that's going to approach infinity. So for p equal to 1, we can say that this integral is divergent. But if p is not equal to 1, well, as t goes to 0, if 1 minus p is a positive constant, then that's just a power of x. And as t goes to 0, then I should have had, I'm sorry, a t here. And I should have had a t here as well. To go back and make the corrections on the previous slides. So, but anyway, if I have t raised to some positive power, as t goes to 0, that's just going to go to 0. So I'll get the finite value 1 over 1 minus p. And that's going to say, oh, well, p has to be less than 1. Now, otherwise, I'll have t, if p is greater than 1, I would have t raised to a negative exponent, which would be like 1 over t to a positive exponent. And as t approaches 0, that's going to go off to infinity. So when will I have a convergent integral? P has to be strictly less than 1. It can't equal 1. And it certainly can't be greater than 1. And so that's the second part of our p-test. So the two parts of the p-test depends on if you have an infinite integral or if you have an integral with the vertical asymptote at x equals 0. So 1 over x to the power of p, the integral from 0 to 1 over 1 over x to the power of p dx is convergent if p is less than 1 and divergent otherwise. So I'm going to stop here. And there's another important way for us to determine if an improper integral is convergent or divergent, which is really useful when we can't find the antiderivative of the integrand or it's very inconvenient. But I'm going to leave that for the next lecture.